So a little bit about me and this talk today. Today we're going to be looking at Spring Cloud, and we're going to be doing a lot of code. I love code. Code is awesome, right? Code is the only differentiator, really. So that's up there on GitHub. If you have the inclination, if you want to follow along at home, please don't hesitate. Grab the bits, kick the tires, and you'll see what we're doing. Don't do it now. Just take a photo and do it later. If you have questions, if you have feedback, if you have ideas, please don't hesitate to reach out to me. I'm on the Twitters. How many of you are on Twitter? Twitter. Twitter. No one.
What about
no
you
one.
10,000 characters?
So if you're, yes. So how many of you are on Twitter? That was actually really sad, really sad. Yeah, okay, I don't even know where to go. How many of you are on email? Email. No one. Right. Well, I'm on those social networks, as the kids say. Don't hesitate to reach out to me. I'm there for you. A little bit about me. My name is Josh Long. I'm a Spring developer advocate at Pivotal, actually, right here, this big cloudy farm. I'm the author now of three best-selling videos on Spring and working on my fifth book, the latest and greatest of which is called The Cloud Native Java from O'Reilly. And that'll be released next month. And that's the same kind of next month as I used when I talked about when this next meeting would be. I'm also a Java champion. That's been my honor. It's been a privilege to be a Java champion. What that means is that I get to be in front of a lot of really, really smart people like yourselves. Trying to understand what they're doing. I talk to a lot of organizations, a lot of customers, a lot of sort of conference goers, and I'm trying to understand what developers are doing today and how they're doing it. And that's put me in front of a lot of really interesting people who are trying to move to this new architecture, right? I do that a lot as well as part of my function at Pivotal, right? So here we are at Pivotal. Pivotal is the home of a lot of great open source stuff, and what that gives us the chance to do is, because people are building on top of this and they're trying to solve real problems, we get to see and understand a lot of interesting use cases. One thing that we've seen in particular is that we see developers moving to this sort of cloud native architecture, right? Cloud native, when Netflix first talked about it back in 2009 or so, referred to sort of this decomposition of their applications from the monolith into this new world of sort of NoSQL and microservices. And there's a lot of reasons for people to embrace this architecture. There's a lot of reasons for people to move to this architecture. What we have seen over and over again is that people are trying to go faster, right? Right now, we live in a world where most interesting industry verticals are being dominated by software, right? So what is the number one taxi service in the world right now? Uber, right? What's the differentiator there? What's the number one thing that lets you send 140 characters? Yeah, it's probably still the mobile phone, but also Twitter, right? Yeah. what is the number one video rental service in the world right now? Right? Yeah, exactly. The differentiator is software. And that speaks to what my friend Andrew Clay Schaefer always says, which is, you're either building a software business or you're going to be beaten by somebody who is. Right? That holds more true than ever. That implies that he or she who can deliver software faster has the better chance of winning. That's the differentiator, speed, right? And so we see organizations struggling to go faster. They have these large monolithic code bases, and they struggle to be able to get new software out on time and in reasonable capacity. They struggle with moving the so-called Titanic of software. They want to be able to react to changes. They want to be able to pivot quickly and safely, right? And that's hard if you have a lot of code that you have to integrate changes from a lot of different developers on. So we see organizations moving to something, they want to go faster, and one way to do that is to have small batches of work, right? This is not a new idea, right? We know from lean manufacturing that small batches of work are much easier to move, to manipulate, to forward through a workflow than large batches of work. You release software as quickly as possible in small batches, but when you start doing this, you're invariably releasing lots of different small pieces that are independently deployable. That implies distribution. That implies network hops. And once you've invited network hops into your life, you're squarely in the camp of distributed computing. And distributed computing is hard, right? There's a lot of pain associated with that movement. So what we're going to talk about today is Spring Cloud, which builds atop Spring Boot, as a way of sort of handling these non-function requirements, the things that you're going to need to care about when you move to this architecture. It is more pain, but the benefit, of course, is agility. It's up to you to decide whether that trade-off is worth it. Hopefully, we can mitigate as much of that pain as possible. So those are my slides. What'd you think? Best ever or best ever? I like these slides. I'm a big fan. They won a Grammy, you know. That was a joke, kids. Never mind. Whatever. It's all right. Moving on. So we're going to start our journey today with kind of where we left off last time. We're going to build a sort of nonsensically trivial microservice. It's going to be a simple service that doesn't connect to the internet at all. Hello? Okay, there we are. It's going to be a simple service that just exposes simple information. And then we're going to look at the things, with the trappings that we need to support in order to talk to that service from a client. Can you all see this in the back, first of all, if I make it a little bit bigger? Okay. This is start.spring.io. This is my second favorite place on the internet after production, right? So I love production more than anything in the world. Spring Boot, by the way, is an opinionated approach to building applications. The opinion is that production is awesome, right? So we're going to build a very, very simple Spring Boot service. I'm going to go here, as I always do, and stand up a new API. I'm going to use the same nonsensically trivial sort of straw man domain that I used last time, which is that of a reservation system, something I can use to record entries of type reservation. So I'll give it a name. I'll say it's called reservation service. I'm going to bring in the web support for building web apps. I'll build in the REST repository support. I'll use JPA because I make poor life decisions. JPA, okay? I'm going to use H2, the embedded in-memory database. How many of you have ever used an in-memory embedded database like H2 or SQLite or Derby or... All right, HSQL. I'm going to use configuration, right? So I'll centralize my configuration. We'll talk about that in just a second. I'm going to use stream processing with Redis. So there's that. I'm going to use... Do I want anything else? Yes, Zipkin, right? And we'll come back to that in a second as well. So we're going to hit generate. By the by, there's a lot more options here, right? You could have gone through this list and chosen the kinds of workloads you'd like to support. This is just Spring Boot. If you haven't had a chance to play with it, do, please. Or better yet, watch the talk that I did in front of this very, very assembly just a few short months ago, okay? A couple of things. It's worth reiterating why we chose jar and not war. Now, this is a very important thing, and I don't want to leave it. I don't want to just leave it there, hanging in the air, unanswered. You know, one of those questions that people could ask. People always ask, why do I choose jar instead of war? Now, there's a lot of reasons to choose either. If you have to absolutely choose a .war, you know, archive, you can. It's there, you know. If by some fluke of physics you are stuck in the distant past, unable to move forward, again, here's .war, okay? But for the benefits of what we're trying to do, which is to move fast and have a consistent operational surface area, and to avoid having to avoid introducing places where we can introduce drift, that is to say the class path on the application server versus the class path on my service, I want to keep these things as close to each other as possible. And so I'll just package everything inside of a .jar. That's a very reasonable thing to do in 2016. This is a big part, as you know, of my personal philosophy of make jar, not war. Now, again, choose what works for you. It's all about choice. We're big fans of choice here at the old Pivotal Ranch, okay? Hit generate. Here we go. Open this up. And your favorite IDE. You can use whatever you want. I always love asking this. How many of you are using Eclipse? Eclipse. STS. Yeah, that's a thing. STS is the Spring tool suite. It's built upon Eclipse. How many of you are using... IntelliJ. Wow, that's right. Yeah, good stuff. Hot sauce. Well done. What about NetBeans? NetBeans. Are you here, sir? Are you here? There he is. I don't know how he follows me to every talk I do on every continent and every city, but it's getting a little weird. We're going to talk to the judge about that. So I'm going to just build up a very simple little API. Can you see the font in the back there, friends? Is that, yeah, that's okay? Good. So I'm going to build a simple, nonsensically trivial API. I'll say class reservation, like so. And it's going to be a JP entity because lazy. And I'll give it a primary key, like so, private long ID. Wow, this is awkward typing. It's on an angle. So private string reservation name, like that. Create some getters, or not, getter. Create a constructor, there we are, for n, and we'll say string. I'll say that I want this to be the reservation name equals n. I'll give it a primary key, like so, at generated value. Okay. And that's it, I think. I need a constructor for JPA, right? This is for JPA. Why? Right. Other than that, I think we're good to go. Now I've got a basic entity. It's going to, you know, we'll use it to store state in the database. I need something to actually do the reading and the writing, and for that I'll use a repository. So I'm going to bring in Spring Data JPA, which is part of an umbrella project, Spring Data, which in turn supports this idea of a repository. A repository, of course, is just an object that handles the boilerplate creation, reading, updating, deleting. And it's in this case, it's declarative. So we don't even have to write the code to do it. It's just an interface that Spring Data will provide an implementation for that we can then use in the balance of our code. So here's our JPA repository. It's got a bunch of useful methods like find all, save, delete, etc. You know, the CRUD style stuff. I can even take it a step further and stand up a, no. When was that ever the right answer? What the heck? I've got a new computer here, so if I look a little uncomfortable in my own skin, it's because of that. So here we are, string rn. I'm going to create a custom finder method, and the finder method will just return all of the reservations when asked by a predicate, which is to say by name, right? So there we are. The parameter, the predicate is rn. And I'm going to use Spring Data REST to expose this as a REST endpoint. Okay? And then finally, I'm going to create a component that implements the command line runner. So I'll say dummy data CLR implements command line runner. And all I'm going to do here is use this callback interface, which Spring's going to see at the application startup. And I'll use that as a chance to insert some dummy data into the database. So I'll say, Peter and Tasha, and some names, please. You guys are not working with this. Eric, Moore. Susie. I like that name, Susie. Okay, next. Like that? I don't know. Okay. So for each name, we're going to say, this.reservationRepository.save equals new reservation. And all I'm doing is I'm creating a component that Spring will see, and it'll, you know, in that, when the application starts up, it's going to see this interface, all beans that have this interface, and it's going to see it's got a callback method called run, and it's going to call the run method, giving us a chance to initiate our application after all the configuration has been sort of stabilized and everything's ready to go. This is very nice, but what I'm really doing is I'm creating a bean, a whole object, a class with its own, you know, name and everything, just for the side effect of having that function called. In a first-class language with first-class support for functions, this wouldn't be something you would do a lot, right? Well, of course, if you're following, you know that Java 8 supports lambdas. So I'm going to turn this into a lambda. This is just going to be an object expressed as a bean that I'm going to return from a function or from a method. Spring will see this bean annotation, it'll see this method, it'll invoke the method, and it'll take the product from that and then create a bean for me. But now, because it's kind of just an anonymous bean, I'm not actually cluttering my namespace a little bit. So I'm going to rewrite this in terms of just an anonymous inner class, which I'll turn into a lambda, right? So new command line runner can be expressed as a very clean little lambda like that. And I can just tell Spring to inject my repository there. And I'll paste that in. And I'm off to the races, right? So that's much cleaner, less code, easier to reason about. And I just wanted you to see there's two different ways of telling Spring about your beans. There's stereotype annotations like this, and then there's at bean like that, okay? Now, we've got that. We should be able to confirm a few things are working. I'm going to go back to my build here and remove a few things that we're not ready to use just yet. So we'll remove that, we'll remove this, and we'll remove this. At enable auto import and run. So control alt D run. What we should see is a REST API using hypermedia. And hypermedia is very, very useful in this case because it promotes self-describing services that you can use after a long period, you're not tied to the URL structure of the API. So that promotes very resilient, very long-running services. So here we go. Localhost 8080 forward slash reservations. Come on. There we are. Can you see that? Localhost 8080 reservations. And there is my REST response. It's a hypermedia API, so each entity in the payload has links. These links tell the client what it may or may not do given a certain payload. It says that if I want to see the deep link for the record called for Josh, I go to reservations forward slash one, etc. I can add custom links here. This forms a sort of protocol. We see this all the time when you're on the web. You see links, and the links tell you if you want to do something, if you want to achieve a result, you click the link and you follow the suite of links until you get to the end, and then finally you have a result. These links tell you, or tell, rather they tell the REST client the same thing. So now I've got a very simple, dead simple REST API up and running. I want to be able to talk to this REST API. And I want to be able to stand up a lot of these things, right? That's the goal here, is to be able to stand up a lot of REST APIs with agility. And when you start doing that, again, you invite complexity. So the first thing that I would like to do is to be able to centralize configuration, right? I've got an application up and running. I can, by convention, go to source main resources application.properties and change the configuration there. I might say, for example, server.port equals 8000, right? And if I restart it like this, it'll restart on port 8000 instead of 8080. But again, I've just got one microservice here, one little service that has a very, very simple domain. It's internally consistent, by the way. That's important. When we talk about moving to microservices, what we're talking about is an internally consistent domain model. Right? You have to formally break apart these domain models. I've seen, I walk into too many organizations and I see on the wall large diagrams, large ERD diagrams, the one ERD diagram to rule them all with 1,000 links and tables. This is a bad idea, TM, right? Avoid this at all costs. What you really want are small, internally consistent domain models. So for example, take the idea of customer service versus sales. In both domains, you have the idea of a product and a customer. But the way you treat a customer in the case of remediation or sales, or rather customer service, is very different than the way you would when you're trying to entice them to buy something. These are two different concepts, though they may share the same noun in English. You're muddying the domain, right? Instead, break them apart, treat them as separate things. Within the context of a single domain, they are very clear and consistent. That boundary, that discovered boundary, is a nice place to describe or sort of to cut apart your microservice, to move and move it off your domain, okay? So keep that in mind. Now, I've got this configuration. I've only got one service. It works here, but what about when I have more than one? When I have even a couple, it gets out of hand. I can, using Spring Boot, I can override this property on the command line. I can say java minus d server.port equals 8000 minus jar, and then run the jar. That's 12-factor style configuration. And that's fine, you know, but again, it becomes a little bit of a problem if I have a suite of services. If I have environment variables, I can do that as well. I can say export server underscore equals port underscore port equals 8000 just before I launch the Java process. But this becomes kind of fragile. If I have more than one service, do I have to log into each node and restart the process? How do I version the changes? What if Josh drinks too much Martinelli's and gets all crazy and logs into production and does something terrible? How do I audit that? How do I see what's happened, see where it's happened? How do I roll back, right? That requires discipline, discipline that at scale is gonna be more and more important to create. Similarly, how do I change things once and have that seen across all of my microservices? Better yet, how do I get it to be seen immediately without restarting the process? For all of these kinds of use cases and more, we need something a bit better, something a bit more sophisticated. We need a separate microservice that babysits the configuration for us. That's a config service. This separate microservice can also do a few other things that we wouldn't want to be able to do, or we couldn't do without a lot more sophistication using this approach. For example, security. If I have a password, do I really want to have scripts, shell scripts with passwords being plugged in as environment variables? That's a terrible idea, right? It's much better to keep the stuff at rest and encrypted in the file system, encrypted, and then symmetrically decrypted in flight from the config service into the microservice. The config service we're going to stand up can do that and more for us. So let's go back to start.spring.io. I'm going to stand up a very simple config service. Here we go. I'll bring in the config server here. And we're off. Now, mind you, what I'm doing is I'm going to just use something to centralize my configuration data. right? The config service is super lightweight. It's very, very convenient. There are, it's built on very, very commodity tools, so it's not hard to integrate it into your workflow. But that said, we also support talking to a zookeeper or a console for configuration sources as well, right? So that's an alternative to what we're about to do. So back to the basics of what we have here. Spring Cloud Config Server, right? That's about it. I'm gonna go back to my application Java code here, and I'll say enable config server. And this is going to babysit configuration files, just as we've used before, application.properties, foo.properties, et cetera. So I need to tell it, first of all, where to find that configuration. I'll say Spring Cloud Config Server Git URI equals, and here I'm specifying the location, the path, to any old Git repository. It could be one on the file system. It could be one on HTTP with GitHub or GitLab or whatever. It doesn't really matter, any Git URI. I happen to have a set of configuration here on my desktop computer. Okay. So there's this, right? It's just a bunch of configuration files in a directory managed by Git. So I'm going to say go to the desktop, /desktop/config. I want this to run on port 8888 on my local machine. That's fine. And that's about it. That'll do. I'm going to spin that up now. Hit go. Ah, sweet nectar. So I can confirm everything's working by going to 8888/. And then what I want to do is I want to see the configuration that a microservice that identifies itself as reservation-service would see. That's the microservice that we've just stood up. We're going to give it a name in a minute, but let's imagine that we've done that. I would go to reservation-service/master, okay? So there's this. Oops. This is the URL, right? Service ID/master. And you can see it says I've got two sets of configuration files. I've got application.properties, which is a fall-through configuration file. All microservices, no matter what their identification, will get the keys and values from that property file. Specifically, only the microservice that identifies itself as reservation-service.properties, or rather reservation-service, will see the configuration file properties inside of reservation-service.properties. But it's a fall-through, right? So the more specific one will always win should there be a conflict, as there is, by the way, in this case. So server.port, in this case, is more specific than server.port in the fall-through file. So you get kind of a hierarchy or a cascade. Let's teach now, let's go back and retrofit our reservation service and teach it how to talk to that configuration server. So we're going to bring in the config client like this. And that'll be, that's basically enough. What I need to do now is to teach my reservation service where to find the configuration and also how to identify itself. So I'm going to change this, and say spring.application name equals reservation-service, and I'm going to say spring-cloud-config.uri equals http localhost 8888. Mind you, the URI could have been an environment variable in of itself, right? So config server, right? That's fine as well. It doesn't really matter, but I'm lazy, so we'll just do that. Now, this information is necessarily needed before the rest of the configuration, right? It's used to bootstrap the configuration process. Without this, the application can't find the config server, which it'll then use to configure everything else. So this file, these two bits of information by definition or by default, should live in a property file called bootstrap.properties. And I find that these are the only two properties that I tend to have copied. That's the only bit of copy and paste you should have in your entire ensemble of services. Okay. So with that in place, we should, at a minimum, see the application spin up on port 8000, not 8080, if we did everything right. And second of all, we can take advantage of this message here. So let's add a little REST controller to parrot or just to print out this message for us, okay? So I'll go back to my code here and I'll say at REST controller, class message REST controller, and I'll say at value, quotation marks message, quotation marks, private string message, request mapping, message, string message, right? I'm just going to return the message from the config server live. Now, if I wanted to change that value, it'd be nice to be able to change that simple value live, right? I don't want to have to restart the process just to do that, though. So I'm going to make this bean refreshable. I'll annotate it with at refresh scope. Okay, so we'll see that in play here now. So let's see if these things work. We should have the application on port 8000, not 8080, and we should be able to access that config value, which is being drawn from the config server. Okay, so localhost 8000 /reservations, that worked, good. So we're connected. What about 8000 /message? There we are, right? But that's a terrible, you know, property value. I don't want that value. That doesn't make any sense at all. I mean, it was fine for its time, but I've moved on. I'm a different developer advocate. That was so 3 weeks ago. No, this is different. We're at the SF Jug, not some namesless department store exclamation marks, okay? So I'll go here to my config repository, Joe reservation service.properties. I'm going to change this, okay? Now say, hello, SF Jug. And I'm going to add a lot of exclamation marks to make my opinion more valid and important on Reddit. Okay, so here we go. And I'll say git commit minus a minus m YOLO. Okay, git status. There we are. So I've got the little dropping there. That's the file editor, you know, Joe. I'll remove that. Okay, so there we are. Nothing left. Now, this config server is immediately aware of the change, right? It sees the new value. My client, my reservation service, which is the client to the config service, is not aware of the change. It still caches the old value. I need to explicitly ask it to reconfigure itself. So I'm going to go back to my command line here, and I'm going to activate what's called an actuator endpoint. Spring Boot has this notion of an actuator endpoints. These are endpoints exposed via JMX, via REST, via whatever you want, really, that give you the ability to see what the system is doing. They let you ask questions. They give you things like, for example, if I wanted to go to /env, I don't have that on this, so I need to restart. Let me see. Did I actually forget the actuator? I think I did. So if you don't have this, this won't work. Okay, there we are. There's the actuator bits. I'll restart the client, and we'll change the property file just one more time because it's already cached again. So there we go. Git commit YOLO. Good. Now, if I go to /env, for example, here's the cached value. We can see all the environment properties. We can see a lot of information about the state of the application. This is good because it gives you an operational perspective on what the application is doing. The actuator framework contributes lots of cool stuff, including, like, for example, a health endpoint. These are the sort of non-functional requirements that I was talking about before that you want to get right and just get right once and never worry about again. One of the actuator endpoints that's contributed is the refresh endpoint, which, when invoked, will cascade through all the beans in the graph and recreate in situ the beans that are annotated with at refresh scope. So that bean that we just created, the REST controller, what we want to do is to make it see the new value. This is the old one, right? I've got the new value here. We can see that times two. So I'm going to activate the curl. I'm going to curl minus D, which is to say an empty post, empty HTTP post. The actuator endpoint. So localhost 8000 /refresh, okay? Whoop, there we go. So there's that. It sees the new value immediately. I just have to call that endpoint and immediately visible. That's very, very useful because now I can do feature flags, right? I can turn things on or off live, dynamically. Right? This is very, very good if I want to decouple release of software from deployment. This is one of those ways to do it. You can do dark launches like this. You can open up a certain feature and make it available to just a subset of your audience. You could even just do simple things like, you know, changing certain behaviors, whatever you want. This is a very, very viable way to go. So that's one thing that's very useful to be able to support a distributed system at scale, is to have central configuration and to be able to refresh that configuration live, right? I also mentioned we can do security. So everything I've just showed you is completely wide open by default, but of course, the Git repository can be secured. You can use a config server, and you can secure the config server itself. You can require a key to be on both the config server and the client so that they have to do an authentication handshake beforehand. And you can do encrypted passwords that are decrypted live and in flight from the server to the client, so that when you write them down in the file, they're encrypted, but in flight they're decrypted, right? You get a lot of features there that are good for a mature operational perspective that you can't get when you're just slinging shell files. Now, this is but one pattern. When you move to a sufficiently distributed system, it becomes useful to decouple resolution of where a service lives from its identity, right? I don't want to have to remember hosts and ports. And of course, you may be reaching to DNS. DNS is certainly one way to solve the problem, but it's a poor fit for large applications. There's a couple reasons. First of all, good DNS is supposed to be cached, right? You're kind of going against the grain when you set a time to live of like zero, right? So you can do that, but you're going against the grain. Second of all, DNS doesn't give us a lot of information about the system itself. It is a nice way of logically identifying a service, but we don't know if that service is even there. There's no way to know that. I can make an HTTP request to a DNS endpoint that's in front of a load balancer where there are no instances available. Zero services are available. And I'm just going to hang. Hopefully I've set a timeout and so on in my client code, but that becomes something I have to worry about. This is one problem. The second problem is that if you're using a modern cloud platform, something like a Cloud Foundry, for example, or a Heroku or whatever, you're going to get load balancing by default. You're going to get DNS-based load balancing, but often that's just round robin, and that's pretty common. Even common load balancers themselves, you know, proper dedicated, you know, sort of load balancers, are going to give you a nice, easy-to-use checkbox for round robin. But if you want to do anything more sophisticated than that, you're going to run into trouble. How do you do, for example, availability zone aware load balancing? How do I say, here's a node in this availability zone, this AWS region, this whatever, this data center, and I want to talk to those only? How do I handle state? For example, suppose I'm some sort of streaming video service. You know, I hear we have those around here somewhere, right? And I want to route requests to the node doing the stateful streaming of the video. Again, that requires a little bit more finesse than you get by default with round robin load balancing. So for these reasons and more, it's useful to introduce a different approach, something called a service registry. A service registry is like a phone book for the cloud. It lets you talk about where services are, how many of them there are, and what their identity is without using DNS. It also lets you do client-side load balancing, right? Client-side load balancing is what we're really after here. So we're going to use Netflix's Eureka, which is one of many supported service registries. We also support Apache Zookeeper, HashiCorp's console, and there's preliminary, though not in mainline, support for etcd, right? So all of these are good options. The first three are already GA, or there will be GA in the next Brixton release of Spring Cloud. So to support that, I'm going to go to start.spring.io, and I'll bring in Eureka. Okay, I'm going to remove here. Start there. Eureka service, Eureka server, generate. And now what I'm going to do is a little weird. I'm using Spring Boot to stand up Eureka itself, right? Normally, I wouldn't use Spring Boot, for example, to stand up Zookeeper, and I wouldn't use Spring Boot to stand up console, which is written in the Go language, for example, right? It just happens to be trivial to do so in this case, but most of what you're going to do is to act as a client to something else, as a service registry. So I'm going to say Eureka service application at enable Eureka server. I'll go to application.properties, and I'll give it a name. I'll say spring.application.name equals Eureka service. And I'll say that Spring Cloud config server config. So, hello. Oh, did I forget to add that? I did, didn't I? So I'm going to add the discovery client as well here. Dependency Spring Cloud starter config. And revisit this. Enable auto import. Server. Hello. By the way, did you see this? This is a new thing that IntelliJ does, and I don't know why this is here. I mean, I understand why, but did you see that tweet? There was a poll going on a few weeks ago on Twitter, which is, and it said, "Are you an awful person?" Tabs or spaces, right? This is kind of what that is. So anyway, let me see here. Config. Server.uri, I think. I don't know. Maven. I think it's just that. I can just copy it from here, I suppose. Configure-i. Aha. So now I'm going to rename this file just as I've done before countless times to be bootstrapped up properties. Okay, and I've got that. That should do. I've got this pointing to the config server where it'll find configuration for the Eureka service. And it'll start up on port 8761 as a result. So here we are, localhost 8761. And there's our sort of straw man basic Eureka registry ready to use. This is the wetware console. There's also a REST API for machines to talk to, of course. What I want is to see our reservation service made available for discovery here. I want to see it enumerated in the list of applications. And in order to do that, I'm going to go revisit our reservation service. I'm going to teach it to talk to Eureka by bringing in the Spring Cloud Starter Eureka dependency. So, Spring Cloud Starter Eureka. So that's going to bring in an implementation of the Discovery Client Abstraction. The Discovery Client Abstraction is a way of it's a client-side interface like this, Discovery Client. Okay, that has a few interesting methods: get local service instance, get instances, and get services. It's basically letting us ask questions of the registry. This is read-only. You'll notice the Discovery Client implementations all provide the ability to ask questions of the registry. Only a few require you to actually talk to the registry to do the do the registration of the service itself. That part is handled for you by the auto-configured implementation, but it's not reflected in this interface because it's not common to all of them. For example, your average cloud provider, something like a Cloud Foundry, already knows where these services live. You don't need to tell it where a reservation service lives. It started the thing in the first place. So there's no need for you to raise your hand and say, I'm here. If you want me, if you want to find reservation-service, I live on this host and port. So we're going to let our implementation do that when we have got this here. We'll restart. And we should see, first of all, when we restart this, we'll see it output. We'll see it reflected in the registry itself here. There it is. So there's our service ready for use. It's reflected in the console there. We can see that it's running on this host and port with this service ID, etc. And when we click on this, it goes to the info endpoint on my service here. So, but that's not there. Why is that? Curious. Well, that's a little weird. It says 8,000, so it'll do the right thing. I haven't actually clicked on this link in a while. It's going to 8080. That's a weirdness. So anyway, it's up and running. Now we can discover it. Now we can talk to it. And so this is where the metal meets the road. We have a chance now to stand up a client for our reservation service, which is exactly what we want to do. This is what we mean by distribution, right? We're going to build an edge service. We're going to build a REST endpoint, but it's going to be an edge service. When I talk about edge services, I'm talking about two different types of things, and you can pick and choose what you want. There's two common types of edge services that I care about. One is called a micro proxy, right? Something that just blindly forwards packets from the outside to the services inside the data center and behind the load balancer. And then another one, a more specialized one, is called an API gateway, which transforms the requests to the services that are behind the load balancer, right? You may have different use cases that require one or the other, or maybe even both. We're going to look at both, but it's important to understand the distinctions. A micro proxy, in our case, might be enough, right? So we're going to build a reservation client here, and I'm going to say that it's going to use Eureka Discovery. It's going to use the config client. It's going to use Hystrix for circuit breakers. It's going to use Zool for a micro proxy. It's going to use Redis stream processing for that. It's going to use Zipkin for distributed tracing. And then we'll hit generate. We'll open this up in our IDE here. I have some more of this stuff. And we'll see at enable discovery client. Application.properties, hello computer. Say spring.application name equals reservation-client. I'm going to say spring.cloud.config.uri equals HTTP localhost 8888. Okay. So that'll be, we have to rename that file to bootstrapped up properties naturally. Okay. So first thing we want to do, maybe a micro proxy is enough, right? What we're going to do is stand up an edge service and have that act as the door from the outside, from our mobile devices, from our watches, from our Teslas, from our washing machines, from whatever, into the services that are behind the ensemble, behind the load balancer, behind the firewall, right? The edge service is going to be stood up through DNS, right? Naturally, that's going to be a static thing. You're not going to teach your iPhone, your Android app, or whatever to speak to Eureka. That's not going to happen. They'll still use DNS. They're going to send requests to this edge service, and that edge service is going to mediate the requests inside and then, you know, forward it on to the right service or services. This is a very useful pattern because it means that you can stand up one kind of service and then transform as necessary at this middleman layer. This is a nice place also to handle client-specific concerns. Netflix does this a lot. They'll have, for example, you know, hundreds and hundreds of microservices and probably just as many different clients or devices that actually talk to those microservices. If these clients have specific concerns that they need to address, it's a non-starter to retrofit every single microservice. So instead, they handle that at the edge service layer. If you have to handle specific types of security, do that at the edge service and then forward on to the services in the back end. If you have to handle certain types of APIs or protocols, again, do that at the edge service and then forward on afterwards, right? This is the edge service. This is the doorman into your ensemble, into your services. So a very simple example of an edge service is a microproxy. Take, for example, an HTML5 application. HTML5 applications can't run afoul of cross-origin request forgery restrictions, right? They have to stay on the same host and port. Of course, I can add a policy to all of my services saying that I permit requests from these places to the service. But again, if you have 600 services, that's a non-starter. Much better to just forward the requests on a single node and port to the services in the back end and then get the responses and proxy them backwards. So we're going to use Zool, also from Netflix. How many of you are up on your Greek and or Ghostbusters mythology? Zool, right? The gatekeeper, remember? He's the gatekeeper, and then there's a keymaster. Yeah, it's terrible. So we're going to use Zool. We're going to say at enable Zool proxy. And all this is going to do is just blindly forward requests from the edge service into the service that we reference in the request. And maybe that's enough. Again, if you add maybe HTTP basic or OAuth at the edge service, stand up the service and use SSL, which is usually a checkbox or even something you can do in Spring Boot, and maybe you're done. Maybe that's enough to sort of enable your HTML5 developers to get everything they need from the back end, right? And maybe that's enough. So let's see what we get. 99.99, which is my reservation client. I'm going to say reservation-service/reservation. So the context here, this part of the URL, is the service ID as registered in our registry, any registry. Again, it's using Eureka in this case, but it could have been Zookeeper or Consul or whatever, right? And it's going to forward the request on to the actual service, /services. And give me the response, just as if I had made the call to localhost 8000/reservations directly. Right? So here's 99.99.99, here's 8000/8000, okay? Proxying in and out, no problem at all. And that's built on Netflix's RX Java, so it's exceedingly fast, etc. Okay? So this is, maybe that's enough. Like I said, maybe that's enough for our use cases. If everything can speak JSON, you're done, right? If I have another service called foo service, I can just reference it like that. I can say foo service instead, right? Now I can move. But let's look at the more complicated case of an API gateway where I need to do API and or protocol translation, right? This is a very common thing. And it may not even be a dramatic transformation or translation. It's just something you have to take care of. So here we're gonna take the reservations coming from the reservation service, strip away all of the surrounding the links and the JSON and all that, and just return the names, right? A collection of string names. It's a nonsensically trivial transformation, but it will give us a chance to explore what we're doing here. So I'll go back to this, kill that out, okay? And I'm gonna build a REST controller And I'll say it's going to be seat. It'll be set at rooted at /reservation. So this is the client. Remember, the client talking to the reservation service. And I'll say reservation API gateway REST controller. And I'm going to support a very simple use case, which is public collection of string get reservation names. Okay, and I'm going to say request mapping equals get value equals reservations, or sorry, names. So it's going to be the full resolved URL will be /reservations/names in order to invoke this endpoint using HTTP GET. Once inside, I'm going to call the reservation service and do a transformation on the result that I get back from that. So I'll say REST template, like so. And what I want to do is I want to say return this.restTemplate.exchange http://reservation-service. This is the service ID, not DNS, again. This is the ID as it's been registered in our registry, okay? Reservation-service/reservations. And I'll use an HTTP GET. I'm not passing in a body. And what I want to do is I want to tell this code to give me an object that represents the reservations that I can use. Remember how the object was structured. It's using hypermedia, right? It's actually using a library called Spring HotiOS, right? Hypermedia is the idea of hypermedia as the engine of application state. It's the library that's being used to generate the payloads that we had in the Spring Data REST-based service, including those links and the payload in the bottom, in the middle. To be able to unwrap that JSON and coerce it back into something, I'm just going to use the same resource representation, the Java class called resource. It's an envelope that has the payload and the links. So I'm going to bring in Spring Boot's support for Spring HotiOS. Okay. What in the hay? Not even close. Hard. Okay, at enable import. What's that? With that in place, I can now just, I want to tell the REST template, listen, what I really want is a collection, or rather, I want the specific subtype called resources, which is a subtype of collection. I want a collection of T, in this case, a reservation, right? I would love to be able to say, for this last argument, I would love to be able to say collection of reservation.class. Of course, I'd love to be able to do that, but that is not a real thing, right? The problem is, of course, because Java doesn't have reified generics, right? When they introduced generics in Java 5, say Spring, they made some compromises in the interest of backwards compatibility. What it means is that at runtime, Java forgets its generic information for instance variables, but it retains that information for subclasses. And if you understand that distinction, then you can do some interesting things. For example, if I ask Java, given a list of string, you know, an array list. No, what? IntelliJ, you're doing the Eclipse thing. Rude. So if I ask it at runtime, what is T in this case? It doesn't know. It forgets. It gets burned away by the compiler at compile time. That's erasure, right? However, if I do this, now it's baked in because I've actually just, in essence, I've created an anonymous subclass. So X is not actually an array list, it's actually a subclass of array list which has no overriding methods. That's what that weird syntax means. Because of that, string is now part of the parent-child hierarchy, right? It's extending, my class X is extending array list of string, not array list of object. So it's baked into the parent-child hierarchy. If you understand that, then we can use that information to capture generic information at runtime using something called the type token pattern. The implementation of that pattern is called the parameterized type reference, right, inside of Spring. That's what we're going to use here. So parameterized type reference of resources of reservation PTR equals new parameterized type reference. And notice I just created an anonymous subclass here as well. So I can pass that in, and that solves half the problem, right? That solves half of our of our problem. But the second problem is, where's the reservation? I don't have that type on the class path. I could, of course, just add the bits from the service itself and add it to the class path, but that would go against the very thing I'm trying to do, which is to keep myself independently deployable. I want to be able to deploy my client without having to couple myself to flag day releases for the service, right? So I want different timelines. I want to be able to evolve my client from the service as necessary. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a client-side representation. I'll say class reservation, just a client-side DTO type thing. And by the way, you know, I've heard, but nobody's ever confirmed, I've heard that it's possible, and again, nobody's ever proven this to my satisfaction, so I'm just putting this out there. It's, in theory, it's possible that the service could have been written in something besides Spring and Java. And again, that's one of those non-Java Spring library technology combinations that doesn't exist, right? But it's out there, and in theory, that if that's true, then I can definitely not risk coupling myself to that non-Java Spring library either. So for all these reasons and more, it's nice to have the client and the service be decoupled. So I'll say private, all I want is the reservation name, right? So I'll say reservation name, and I'll say get that, okay? And there we go. So that'll give me, what this will give me back is a response entity of resources of reservation. The response entity is the HTTP request envelope that comes back. It has the headers and the status code and all that stuff, as well as the body. The body is, of course, our resources of reservation, which, and resources, of course, is just a collection with links, and then the payload is a collection. So I'm going to get the body. I'm going to get the content, which is the collection of reservations, and I'll say stream.map. I'm going to map, using Java 8 lambdas, I'm going to map from the reservation to the reservation name, and I'll collect the output in a list here. I'll say collectors to list, and return that back to the client, okay? So all I've done is I've taken the results, mapped them from a collection of reservations to reservation string name, or rather reservation name, and I've returned that back to the client. If I were calling more than one service at a time, this would be something that would be an ideal fit for something like RxJava, right? You wouldn't want to do synchronous, stepwise sort of invocation of multiple services like this. It's much better to do it concurrently and then sort of zip the results back together and then send them back. But I've only got one request happening here and so on. And also, bear in mind, I don't have a lot of results in this case. I've got, what did we do, like 5 or 6 records? And if I was trying to stream the results, it's much better to return an RxJava observable here, okay? So with that, we should be able to stand it up and see it working. I'll drink some more of my, whatever this is. So localhost 9999 /reservations/names. And there's our collection of names being returned from the service back to the HTML5 client or the iPhone or the watch or whatever. Okay? That's fine. Works just fine. But we've conveniently, for the sake of simplicity, ignored the realities of distributed computing, right? We all know about the fallacies of distributed computing. This is not a guarantee, right? The idea that that I can call that service and have it be guaranteed to be available is farcical at best, right? I need to be a little bit more defensive, especially when I'm building edge services. I can't just send a stack trace back to my iPhone client, right? That's bad form. It's just a really, really bad experience for the users. So you need to be a little bit more defensive. Netflix does this all the time. They may have, for example, a service like the search service, which is down, and they'll say, well, the search isn't working, but here are some recommendations from across the web, something like that, right? You do something in place of nothing, right? Instead of just throwing up your hands and returning a stack trace. So what we want to do is have a fallback experience, something stateful that will take place if this should fail, if the call should fail, right? When you build microservices, you are, like I say, inviting complexity in the form of distributed computing. One way to solve that is to use the circuit breaker pattern. So we're going to use Hystrix, also from Netflix, right? So Hystrix is a circuit breaker. It's a stateful flag or stateful watch around a potentially shaky service-to-service call. And if the call explodes, it sort of flips the switch and it routes traffic to a fallback path, like a fallback train track, okay? So we're gonna activate that by saying at enable circuit breaker. And then we're gonna go up here, We're going to build a fallback method that will do, you know, in this case, it'll just return an empty array list. So I'll say get reservation names fallback. And I'll say return, collect, you know, return new array list. Okay. And I'm going to go up here and I'll say Hystrix command fallback method equals get reservation names fallback. Okay. Because remember, we have the service registry in place. And that the client-side load balancing is actually happening right now as well. So what I didn't explain earlier was when this URL gets executed, it grabs something called, it grabs the service ID, goes to the configured service registry, which it knows about through the discovery client abstraction, gets all N instances of the service as registered in the registry, and has to pick from among them which service to route the request to. If there are 10, and then by default, you have round-robin load balancing, and each instance has a 1 in 10 shot of being invoked. The component that does the load balancing is something called Ribbon. Ribbon is Netflix's client-side load balancing library. It's just that. It's just a way of sifting through N items and picking the right one. It's programmable. You can write an implementation that does what you want and version control it and unit test it and then have it configured so that when you use Ribbon for a different use case, it can use your stateful session aware, you know, sticky session aware or availability zone aware or whatever, aware load balancer, right? Now you've moved the decision about routing from the service, which could change at any minute and may break other clients who have assumptions about that, to the client where now you can have full control over it, right? So that'll work in this case for 1 to N instances of the service. If there's one or more instances, this call will work. If there are 0, it's gonna blow chunks, and that's what we're trying to prevent here is that bad experience. So here's the service call working, right, just as before. It's because the service is now available. If we go to window reservation service, and then we kill it, we get the empty collection. And that's stateful. So not only is it going to work, but it'll back off eventually and try again later, but it won't keep hitting this downed service, giving it time to recover. If you're using a modern technology, a modern cloud platform, something like a Cloud Foundry, right, it's going to move heaven and earth to make sure that if you say that there should be at least 5 instances of an application up and running, that, darn it, there will be 5 instances of that application running. But you need to give it time to do its work. If something falls down, it has to pick it back up, and that takes a little bit. It takes a few seconds, but it still takes time. In the meantime, you need to build your software to be smart about doing the right thing in that bad experience, you know, the degraded case, right? So we've used REST here to read from one service to another. When you're trying to do writes, this isn't quite satisfying enough because you can't make any guarantees. If you're looking for distributed state synchronization, this invites complexity. The lazy architect at this point reflexively reaches for something like distributed transactions. I urge you to have a shot of whiskey and ignore this impulse at all costs, okay? Distributed transactions serve only to slow down the aggregate system, not to mention they are not actually as guaranteed as we all think they are, right? So instead, we're going to use eventual consistency. We're going to use messaging, right? The idea that I can forward a write to a buffer which will store it and guarantee eventual delivery. So if the service is down, it'll work eventually, right? You have to build your system to be a little bit more tolerant of that, but it does have a lot of benefits. So let's stand up the reservation service again. Actually, I don't even think we need to. Here, kill it for now. We don't need to do that now. So we're going to go back to the reservation client. We're going to build another endpoint here that will take a write and then forward the write to our reservation service on a message bus, on a broker, through a message queue. I don't want to be too aware of where this broker is. I want to have the same sort of locational decoupling with my messaging code as the registry gives me for my REST code, right? I can speak about abstract services using their ID without worrying too much about how that stuff comes together. And I can also wire my services together using just their IDs in the code. I want to have the same ability when I use messaging. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use something called Spring Cloud Stream. Spring Cloud Stream is that. It's just that. It's a way of describing services, messaging-based services, and then composing them outside of the actual code in some sort of extra layer. That could be something like Spring Cloud Data Flow, or you could just do it in configuration, right? What you're going to do is you're going to say, I am going to receive a message or send a message on this abstract thing called a channel. channel is a named conduit, basically it's a pipe. If you push a message into the pipe, it'll come out the other end. Spring Cloud Stream will make sure that that other end is probably a broker, you know, that'll forward the message to some other component. What that other component is or where it is or all that stuff, that lives in the configuration external to the code, which means that if you have a service, if you have a stream processing solution where you have one or more services and messages have to flow from one to another, it's all just configuration. And if you want to insert something in the middle, that's no problem, right? So we're going to enable Spring Cloud Stream. We're going to say at enable binding. And this is going to be a source, right? This is the reservation client. It's going to be the source or producer of a message, of data into the pipeline. So we'll say enable binding source.class. Now this is an annotation coming from our Spring Cloud Stream implementation. I'm going to use Spring Cloud Stream Redis. You can use Kafka or RabbitMQ or whatever, or Redis, or you know, a lot of different other things. What you get when you use this at enable binding is that it's going to look at this class literal. It's going to follow it. In this case, this is a class literal that we provide out of the box. You can use your own interface. We don't care. Just any interface with message channel definitions. The rest of this is just for convenience. You don't need any of this stuff. All that we care about is this message channel output. Message channel is, like I said, it's that named conduit. We leave it to the framework to synthesize, to actually create that working thing, and then to tie it to some sort of broker to actually handle the plumbing. Okay? All we care about is that once this thing is materialized, I can now inject either the message channel and then qualify it using this annotation, or just inject an object of type source. Either way, I can dereference the pipe, put messages in there, or receive messages from it, however I like. Okay? So, I'm going to do that just here. I'll say at AutoWired private source, like that, okay? And I'm going to create a new endpoint that takes a read, or write rather. So it'll say request mapping method equals post, okay? And I'm going to say public void write reservation. I'm going to say that the request will contain a JSON. So I'll say it's going to be a JSON object that we're going to marshal from the JSON into a reservation entity. And I'm going to say this dot source dot output dot send. I'm going to send a message. I'll say message of T, in this case message of string, will be message builder dot, or with payload dot get reservation name dot build. I'm going to put that in the channel like that. And that'll be enough. So now we've got something that'll be sent out to on the broker, and then it'll land somewhere else, right? Like I said, the configuration for that, where that actually happens, is external. So we can go back to our config repo here. We can see, for example, on the reservation client config file that we have Spring Cloud Stream bindings output equals reservations. Output is asterisk. It can be whatever you want. That corresponds to the name of the channel in our interface. If you have more than one channel, then you have more than one entries in your config file that look like this. So what we're saying is output, the logical name output in our Java code should connect or synchronize or rendezvous with actual memory on some sort of broker somewhere that can be identified using reservations. Both the client and the service will agree upon this bit right here. This is the name of the memory in the buffer somewhere where the messages will rendezvous. Right? Similarly, if you go to reservation service, /master, you see Spring Cloud Stream bindings input equals reservations on the reciprocal side. Okay? What that string means depends on the implementation of the binder that you have on the class path. In this case, we have the Redis binder, so it corresponds to a queue in Redis. If you're using a RabbitMQ, it'll correspond to an exchange in a queue or a destination or whatever, depending on the broker. Okay? So now we've got that on the client side, the source side. Let's go back to the sync side, the thing that receives the messages. The consumer, and we're going to build the reciprocal code. We'll say at enable binding after we've brought back in Spring Cloud Stream Starter Redis. We'll say sync.class, and again, sync.class is just a convention I'm using because I've only got one connective thing here happening. But if I have multiple brokers that have multiple flows, I can have an interface with 10 channels on it and just wire them up appropriately. So here, I'm going to say that I want to use Spring integration, the component scan there. I'm going to build a component that will respond to message endpoint. It'll respond two reservations that come in from the broker. So I'll say reservation processor. I'll say service activator input equals sync dot input public void accept new reservations, and the payload will be the string name from the JSON that we got on the other side. And over here, I'll do as I did before. I'll say at AutoWired reservation template, reservation, I'm sorry, reservation process, no, reservation repository. And once I've gotten the response, I'm going to say save new reservation RN. So I'm just going to save the record to the database on the service side. But I'll forward their message to the service using messaging. Okay. So this is the service. Let's start this up. This should now work. Did you hear that? No? Oh, so good. Merry Christmas. Oh. So, let's see. Localhost, 8,000 reservations. There we are. There's that. Now we go back to the client here. See this. Okay, there we are. Now we go back to here. Here's our micro proxy, or rather an API gateway. It's working. So let's now, instead of reading, let's go ahead and send a request. I've got a postman request here. I'm going to configure a HTTP post to HTTP localhost 9999 /reservations. The body will just be this request. It'll be, I need another name. First one? Class? What? Max. We already did Max. It has to be unique. Victor. VI, like that? Sorry. Okay. Okay. Is that right or no? I'm not sure. Okay. And then that should do. So if we see over here, we've already got Josh, Peter, Tasha, Eric, Susie, and Max. Hit send. Go there. And there's Victor twice because I hit it twice. All right. So it sent the request through Redis, out the other end, and then we wrote it to the database. That's good, right? It's fast. It gives us the ability to now not worry that even if the reservation service is down, that we're going to drop messages on the floor. We get guaranteed consistency eventually. This is important. It's easy to pull together complex services like this using Spring Cloud. A big part of what we talk about when we talk about cloud-native applications, however, is an emphasis on visibility into what the system is doing. So let's now turn to two other things before we wind down for the evening. One is the Hystrix dashboard, which will let us see those stateful circuits in the system and kind of visualize what's happening as traffic flows through those potentially shaky circuits. And then we're going to also look at something called Zipkin, which is from, believe it or not, Twitter, right? You wouldn't know anything about Twitter, would you? Yeah. So here we go. Let's see, first things first, start.spring.io. We're going to go back here, Hystrix dashboard, config, client. Okay, oops, got two of them for no reason. Okay. And all this is a simple dashboard that expects a heartbeat stream that we can use, that all the services that have circuit breakers in them will emit. So we'll say at enable. Hystrix dashboard. We'll say application.properties. I'm just going to copy this application.properties, or bootstrap.properties. Okay. And we're going to call this Hystrix dashboard. And we'll rename this file to bootstrap.properties. And we've got that. So now we can start this up. And it's a simple dashboard that expects a service end event-based stream, a heartbeat from the circuits. Again, if you have more than one component, which you likely will, you're going to want to be able to federate all of the streams from all of the circuits and all of the system into one stream. You can do that with something called Spring Cloud Turbine, which integrates Netflix's Turbine, which is a way of federating the streams like that. So now I can go to, 8010. 8010/Hystrix.html, and there's a little dashboard. I'm going to plug in the stream, like I say. By default, I'm going to use the stream on the circuit breaker on the reservation client, which is called istrix.stream. And you can see it's continuously updating. It's server send event, so whatever you do, do not curl this. Okay. We're going to paste that in here, hit monitor. And now we can see this, close that. Where's our little dashboard here? Do I have anything? Whatever. 99 /reservations/names. As I make, I'm hitting Command R as fast as my little fingers will let me. On the left, it's driving traffic through the circuit, and it's driving up the graph upwards, right? It's moving it upwards, trending upwards. It's a moving average, however. So as I lay, if I lay off the gas, throttle the gas, you'll see that eventually the moving average, I'm not even making requests anymore. Immediately, you know, it'll fall down again, right? So you can see right now traffic is flowing very happily through the system. We can see that represented here. Only one circuit, but it's very useful. Now, let's go kill our poor little reservation service one more time. Okay. Goodbye. Now, this fails, and you can see on the right, it's saying that 100% of the requests are failing. So you get a big red glowing ever-expanding ball telling us that something is wrong. This is very important because now I can see what's happening. I can see what needs to be done. Obviously, again, if you have something like a Cloud Foundry or whatever underneath you, it'll pick up the application and eventually things will be fine. But now you have visibility into what's happening. This is very important. That's one use case. The other one is when I have a lot of applications, I want to be able to trace and correlate what requests cause what kind of trouble, right? So distributed tracing is something that's, in theory, very, very simple to do in a complex system. In practice, it turns out to be a real pain in the butt. What you need to do, in theory, is propagate some sort of UUID, a correlation ID, across the requests for a single request, from a single aggregate request. You need to originate the request, propagate some sort of UUID in that request, and then continue to propagate that UUID across all the contexts where that request travels. We have an abstraction inside of Spring Cloud called Spring Cloud Sleuth. Spring Cloud Sleuth provides the instrumentation that you need to automatically do that, right? It'll instrument, for example, HTTP message calls from one service to another. It'll instrument Spring MVC so that if anything comes in from Spring MVC, that actually automatically gets the headers added as well. It'll instrument RabbitMQ and Redis. It'll instrument the Feign declarative REST client. It'll instrument just a lot of stuff, right? It'll handle that automatically all for you when you configure it. So we have that running in a Docker image here. Let's make sure that's working. Good. So now let's go back and teach our code, our reservation service, first of all, to participate in distributed tracing. I'm going to go back to the build and make sure that I have Spring Cloud Starter Zipkin here. Okay. And I'll go back to my code and I'll add an object of type sampler. Now, the reason I need to do this is because Spring Cloud Stream doesn't know what requests it should trace and which ones it should not. Sleuth, by the way, will trace and then collect that information. But we have an implementation of Spring Cloud Sleuth that will write out that information to Zipkin. So that's what we're using, is Spring Cloud Starter Zipkin, which is a specific implementation of the Sleuth abstraction. Okay, so I'm going to create a sampler object. A sampler is useful because, again, Spring Cloud Sleuth doesn't know what you want to trace, right? So you have to tell it. You could trace everything, but that's a kind of a terrible idea, because if you have all the traffic through all the services being routed to your tracing tool, it'll knock it over very, very quickly. It doesn't matter how powerful that tracing tool is in a sufficiently complicated system. So if you're going to have trouble, believe me, you'll see it in 20% of the requests, for example. Right? So a good idea is just to create a sampler and to tell it which requests or how many requests should be sampled. Here, I'm going to just say always sample, right? It's a demo. I want to show everything. So I'm going to replace it with a lambda, which is nice. Here we go. Command C, that's my reservation service. Let's go to the reservation client. Here, kill that. Okay. And I need to make sure I have Zipkin on the class path here. Yep, I've got it there. So let's go back to the service. be started. Okay, up and running, good. Now go back to the client, restart that, and close this. There's our client request to the reservation service. As I drive traffic through that, you'll see it there. Now I can go back to the zip image running in my Docker container somewhere else. I'm going to go here, and it shows me reservation client and reservation service. I'm going to go for reservation client, hit find, and that'll shows me one span, one trace. So a trace in the Spring Cloud Sleuth abstraction is the aggregate distance or travel of a request through all the different contexts. A span is each individual hop in that journey, okay? So we can see the whole span as well as, we can see the whole trace as well as each individual span. So less than a minute ago, I made a request. It's got two spans. It says that I made a call in the reservation service. It took this many milliseconds. I can see the timeline. I can actually click on it and get the detailed headers, the information of the request acquire and then the release, you know, on its journey, the headers that were propagated from the HTTP request. And then over here, I can see when it was handled by the other side, right? So all this information is automatically available for you and visible inside of Zipkin. It makes it very easy to see the aggregate journey of a request in a system. If service B in the middle of service A and service C falls down and you want to know why, this is invaluable, right? It gives you the ability to really understand what your system is doing. And as a thought experiment, remember that sampler could be a refreshable bean. So you could change the percentage or whatever if you needed to. Right? You could say, oh, well, something's wrong. I want to see what's happening. Let's up the percentage. Okay, so we have looked at just a few things here tonight, just a little bit. I regret that we didn't have a lot of time to really kind of get into it, you know? I feel like we didn't cover anything at all, but maybe next time. Maybe next time. Now, today we've looked at how to stand up a very simple little service with a Spring Boot. We've used Spring Data REST to make short work of standing up a Hypermedia API, which is good because it promotes long-running, long-living services that last, you know, much more than if you built and clients that were coupled to the URL topology. We stood up a centralized configuration server, one of many options, a very good one, that you can use to centralize configuration and enable things like symmetric decryption and encryption, and feature flags, live reloading of configuration. Then we introduced a service registry, and the service registry gave us the ability to handle client-side load balancing using Netflix's Ribbon, right, which is very, very powerful because now you don't have to be a victim to the blindness that DNS imposes upon your system. And then we looked at how to make our application a little bit more robust in the face of failure, right? We used circuit breakers to isolate potentially shaky service-to-service calls and to make sure that there was a fallback path if required. We used distributed messaging. We used eventual consistency to make sure that writes from one system to another were also guaranteed to eventually be delivered and handled gracefully if the service were down. Then we turned just a little bit, and we focused on shining a light on the state of the system, right? Being robust in the face of failures is one thing. Being able to react and respond to it is quite another, and that requires, this is not an option, it requires visibility. It requires a mature operational sensibility. You don't drive your car with black paint on the windows and all your gauges turned off, do you? It's a bad idea for one car. Now imagine you, by yourself, are driving 100 cars, and they're all with one, you know, windshields obscured and everything. It's a dangerous idea, right? So anything less than complete visibility into the system is asking for trouble. It's not worth doing. Just stop. Just don't do it. So when we talk about Spring Cloud, we care about maturity and resilience of systems, and we also care about being able to see what the system is doing and react accordingly. I didn't even get a chance to really kind of talk to you about what we could have done to handle remediation, right? There's a lot of great technologies out there for remediation flows, right? If you think about this common reasons that systems fall down. A lot of that is stuff that, based on good tracing and good instrumentation, you can respond to automatically. You can make the robots carry the pager instead of you, right? Get that night of sleep. A good platform like Cloud Foundry will do a lot of that for you, but again, it's nice to handle the complex stuff if you can as well. I feel like there's a lot more we could talk about. Spring Cloud also handles, for example, single sign-on. So if you have more than one service and you want to have a single sign-on where you can actually authenticate once and then propagate tokens across your REST services, that's very, very dead simple to do. OAuth tokens, right? That's simple. If you want to see more, check out start.spring.io. Start your journey with Spring. If you want to learn more about Spring Cloud in specific, there are guides that are coming up online on spring.io/guide. I've got a little book you might like and I don't know, sometime soon. Thank you very much. What did you guys all think, guys and gals? It's on Git. So as I said in the very beginning, right up front, where did I? Well, it's github.com/long, beautiful microservices. Okay. So the code in here is actually specific to Brixton. I'm using a lot of the new bits inside of Spring Cloud Brixton, which should be released this quarter. But Spring Cloud Angel is the first 1.0 GA release of Spring Cloud. This stuff is getting a lot of traction, by the by. There are some small mom-and-pop shops that have really, really kind of caught into this stuff. So Netflix has already talked very, very publicly about how they're using Spring Cloud, in this case, to consume their own stuff a lot of times and to consume other people's bits, right? It helps them go faster. They like what they're doing, but of course, a lot of it is rough, right? So this is much more efficient and elegant, not to mention it offers a lot that they don't have out of the box. Baidu, anybody hear of Baidu? They're a small mobile analytics company out of China. They service like 700 million Chinese people a day. Anybody? No? No one? Okay, well, they're using Spring Cloud. Alibaba. Anybody hear of Alibaba? Alibaba. They made $14 billion in one day last year. They're like Amazon, but four times bigger in terms of single day profits. They're also big Spring Cloud users. They've talked about that as well. Ticketmaster. They're the masters of tickets. Anybody hear of Ticketmaster? Ticketmaster. Their whole service platform is on top of Spring Cloud, right? So this is a very, very powerful way to build really complex systems. I hope some of it appeals to you. Remember, I showed you everything as we went. You can consume all of this stuff a la carte, right? Just check boxes after all. All right, thank you very much. If you have questions, I'm here for you. I appreciate you coming. I hope you'll come back again. And by the way, Twitter, right? So at Starbucks Man on the Twitters, or Spring Central for the larger group, right? There's that. Don't hesitate to reach out.